Please stay tuned for a very special presentation of the King is Coming telecast. The Bible tells us that in the last days there will be a terrible financial crisis, a dramatic increase of knowledge, a sudden outbreak of disease, devastating wars, and the call for a one-world system. Sound like today? It also says that before the crisis comes to a head, millions of Christians around the world will disappear. Today on The King is Coming, a special presentation designed to be left behind for the people who are left behind, explaining what has really happened and what they need to do in order to be saved. So use your imagination for the next half hour. Imagine that you have been left behind, and this message is for you. What should you do?
I have a special message for you today of hope and encouragement, of comfort, and yet of direction. Right now, the world is in a state of shock. Millions of people have suddenly disappeared without any warning, without any real clear explanation. Oh, the media may be suggesting that aliens kidnapped them or laser beams zapped them or somehow they were departiculized and they've gone into another dimension or whatever, and we'll do everything we can to attempt to find them. But I want to tell you what's really happened so that you'll understand what you need to do and what steps you need to take to protect yourself in the days ahead. The very fact that you're watching this video right now means that somebody that loves you either sent you this DVD or they have left it behind for you to discover so that you would understand what does it mean to be left behind. Left behind from what? And in fact, the most important question you're probably asking yourself right now is, what in the world has happened? Let me try to help you understand it, and let me try to explain it to you. When we answer the question, what in the world has happened, the Bible calls this event the rapture of the church. It's clearly explained in the scripture. When Jesus himself met with the disciples on the last night before he went to the cross, he said to them, I'm going now back to heaven, to the Father's house. And if I go, I will come again and receive you unto myself. He made that promise to believers. The rapture of the church is an event that happens for Christian believers that know Jesus Christ as their Savior and are in Christ, a term that's used 53 times in the New Testament to identify those that belong to the true church of the Lord Jesus Christ. It's not a church that had a denominational label necessarily of any name at all. It's those that really know the Lord as their personal Savior. You say, Ed, how can I know what this was all about? Is it really in the Bible? If you've got a Bible available to you, you might look up the passage, 1 Thessalonians chapter 4, beginning at verse 13. In that passage, the Apostle Paul, way back in the first century, explained this event that ultimately would happen in the future. In this passage, Paul said this, "For we would not have you to be ignorant, brethren, concerning those that are asleep, those that have died, that you sorrow not as others that have no hope. For if we," he's addressing believers here, "if we believe that Jesus died and rose again, even so them also that sleep in Jesus will God bring with him. Those that have died have gone on to heaven to be with the Lord. Their spirit has returned, and their body has now been resurrected and reunited with their spirit. For this we say to you by the word of the Lord, that we which are alive and remain unto the coming of the Lord will not precede those that are asleep or those that have died. For the Lord himself shall descend from heaven with a shout, with the voice of the archangel, and with the trumpet of God, and two things will happen. The dead in Christ will be raised, and they shall rise first. Secondly, we which are alive and remain shall be caught up together with them in the clouds to meet the Lord in the air, and so shall we ever be with the Lord." This is a message of comfort for believers, to be comforted by the fact that the dead in Christ one day will rise, that we that are alive and remain will be caught away with them. That term, caught up, harpazo in the original Greek New Testament, means to be snatched away, to be caught away. It's the term that we refer to from both Latin and English as a rapture, to be raptured up, just as a dead body can be resurrected from the grave. So a living body can be raptured away That's the biblical explanation why all of a sudden millions of people are missing all over planet Earth. These are people that really genuinely knew the Lord as their Savior. Now, somebody may be watching this saying, well, I thought I was a believer, or I'm a member of a church, or I at least believe in God, or I've had some kind of a spiritual experience. But remember, Jesus said, narrow is the way that leads unto life. Broad is the road that leads to destruction. There are only a few that find the narrow way to Christ, the way that comes through faith in the Lord Jesus. Too many people are trusting their own good works to get them to heaven, thinking, well, I'm better than the guy next door, so I should have been taken on to heaven. No, salvation is not based on your good works. It's based on the great work of Jesus on the cross, who died for your sins, who shed his blood for you, who gave his life for you. It's what he did on the cross that God accepts as a payment for our sin, and by which our faith expressed in that gives us the gift of eternal life. If you've been left behind, it means you never really knew Jesus as your Savior at all. And then 2 Thessalonians, the very next book in the New Testament, explains what to expect in the days ahead. This passage tells us, beginning in verse 3, let no one deceive you by any means. That day will not come, except there come a falling away first, and the man of sin be revealed, the son of perdition. It reminds us that an evil world ruler is coming on the scene. Now, right now, he may not seem evil. He may be seen to be promising peace and success and prosperity, and out of all this chaos, I'll bring order. Trust me, follow me. But the Bible says he opposes and exalts himself above all that is called God or that is worshipped, so that he as God will ultimately go to the temple of God, showing himself that he is God, demanding that the world worship him as God. And then the Apostle Paul said to the Thessalonians, don't you remember when I was with you, I told you these things. But right now there's someone restraining his arrival, something holding back the arrival of this Antichrist, the wicked one, the son of perdition, the lawless one. The mystery of iniquity is already at work, but once the restrainer is removed and taken out of the way, then the wicked one will be revealed. That restrainer has been removed. The church of the Lord Jesus Christ of genuine born-again believers is now gone. God has called his family home to heaven. He's about to declare war on the world, and you've been left behind. You say, what in the world can I expect? What's going to happen next? Does the Bible not only tell me what will happen when the rapture occurs, what will happen to those that are left behind? And is there any hope for me at all? We'll come back in a moment and we'll see what the Bible says. If you're watching this and you've been left behind, you're probably asking yourself, what's next? If millions of people have suddenly disappeared, if it's really the rapture of the church that's predicted in the Bible, then what's going to happen to those that have been left behind? Well, unfortunately, the Bible describes this time as the time of great tribulation, a time of suffering, a time when the wrath of God is going to be poured out on the world. Jesus himself predicted such a time. In the Gospel of Matthew, the 24th chapter, Jesus said this in verse 21, for there shall be great tribulation, such as was not since the beginning of the world to this time, no, nor shall ever be. It'll be worse than anything the world has ever seen. And except those days be shortened, no flesh would be saved. He predicts a time of trouble that is coming on the world. The Old Testament prophets made such a prediction that judgment and trouble is coming, especially for the nation and people of Israel, the time of Jacob's trouble. But it's also a time of trouble for the whole world. When we read the book of Revelation, look at chapters 6 through 18. They describe seven seals that are opened by Christ the Lamb, seven trumpets that are sounded by the angels, seven bowls of judgment poured out by the angels. Altogether, 21 judgments of divine wrath poured upon the earth. That's what's coming in the days ahead. Right now, people may be talking peace, stability, even prosperity. Out of all of this chaos, somehow we'll pull things together. We'll find a way for the future. The scripture warns in 2 Thessalonians chapter 2 that people will believe the lie that something other than the rapture has occurred, that they have not been left behind. There are some who are thinking to themselves, well, I'm a good person, or I'm a church member, or I have had a spiritual experience of some kind. Surely God would not leave me behind. But if you've been left behind and millions of people are missing, you need to face the fact that you're not really saved, you've never been born again, and that's why you're still here. And then what you're facing in the future is what the Bible calls the great day of the wrath of God Almighty. Read those chapters in the book of Revelation. The trees and the grass burn up. The water and the air are polluted. Armies are marching. Men are fighting. The world is at war. The book of Revelation predicts that a third of the world will die, and then another third again. Altogether, half the world's population is facing extinction in the years ahead, a time of food shortages, of unparalleled human suffering, of incredible devastation, where people are literally gasping for life itself. No wonder Jesus said, unless those days were shortened, nobody would survive. Is there any hope? Yes, there is. Some will come to faith even during this time, but many will not. You'll hear many people saying, I'm not going to believe it was the rapture. I'm not going to believe we're in the tribulation. Somehow we'll just get our way through this thing. The Bible tells us over and over in Revelation 6 and in Revelation 9, they did not repent, they did not repent, they did not repent. They shook their fist in the face of God and said to the rocks and the mountains, fall on us, hide us from the wrath of the Lamb. But they did not come to the Lamb, to Christ Himself. It is during this time of tribulation that a great world leader will come on the scene. The Bible calls him the beast, the Antichrist, the man of sin, the son of perdition, the lawless one, etc. Oh, he may be promising to bring peace to the world. He will even promise to bring peace to the Middle East. But the scripture tells us ultimately he'll plunge the world into war, and the war will culminate in the Battle of Armageddon. As we read the book of Revelation, it becomes evident throughout that entire book that the world is in chaos in the time of the tribulation. Now, we believe that it'll last for 7 years, that it's paralleled to the 70th seven of Daniel's prophecy in the 9th chapter of the book of Daniel in the Old Testament, that God had determined 69 sevens, 483 years of history for the Jewish people from the time they rebuilt the city till the time the Messiah came and Christ was killed and crucified on the cross. But there are still 7 more years yet to be clicked off on the clock of God's plan for the world, and God's plan in particular for the nation and people of Israel. You've got 7 years before Jesus finally returns and the great battle of the great day of God Almighty takes place. Revelation 16, verse 16, calls it the Battle of Armageddon. It's the only place in the Bible where that word appears, but everybody knows what it means. The final war between Christ and Antichrist, between the forces of God and the forces of evil. And when it is over, the final bowl of judgment is poured out in Revelation 16, 17, and the voice of God speaks from the throne of heaven saying, it is done, finished, bad news, too late. Judgment has fallen. The wrath of God is a reality, and tragically, millions and millions of people will die who have turned their back on God for all of these centuries, for all of these years of their own personal experience, and who have said, I'll live my own life, I'll do it my own way, I don't need God. Could I remind you, you need Him right now more desperately than you have ever needed Him. You need to turn to Him yourself before it's too late. If millions will die, you have no guarantee you'll even live through the tribulation period. You have no guarantee at all about the future in this moment of tragedy. Now is the time to come to Christ. Revelation, the 7th chapter, tells us that there are many that will be saved out of the great tribulation. You say, how could I be saved? Is there still hope for me? Is there still time? What do I need to do? I'll come back in a moment and I'll tell you exactly what to do and what to expect. Jack, a lot of people realize if they're looking at the Bible right now that if I become a believer during the time of the tribulation, I may well lose my life for the cause of Christ. Is it going to be worth it?
Oh my, first of all, the Bible says in Hebrews 9:27, it's appointed unto every man once to die, and then comes the judgment. So we're all going to die. It's how you die, and it's for what you die for. And so personally, I would rather die for Jesus Christ today or any day than to die for a life half-lived, to die for a life that missed him, to die having a life that was never fulfilled. Oh, if someone was to accept Christ today, their next few moments, their next few months, their next few years will be more life lived for him and more of a glory to die for him in peace and joy than any life lived for some material, momentary self-gratification. Absolutely.
You know, the Apostle Paul put it this way. When he was facing the end, he said, "For me to live is Christ, and to die is gain." To gain even more, his presence in heaven forever. If you've been left behind and you find yourself in the time of tribulation, you're probably asking yourself, what should I do? Could I remind you, you need to do the same thing people have always needed to do, and that is to believe that Jesus is the Christ, the Son of the living God, that he died on the cross for your sins, that he shed his blood on your behalf, that he took the punishment and wrath of God against your sin on the cross, but now you've been left behind in a world in which the wrath of God is being poured out on the entire planet. Is there any hope for me, you might ask? Yes, there is. Take a Bible, find Revelation, the 7th chapter. You'll discover that there are at least two groups of people in that chapter that have an opportunity of salvation. In Revelation 7, verse 4 tells us, there were 144,000 of all the tribes of Israel, and they are described as coming from the 12 tribes of Israel, at least 144,000 Jewish people that come to faith in Christ, who ultimately are witnesses for Christ for their faith in him, and eventually many of them will even give their lives for their faith in Christ, and many more of the Jewish people will be saved. But salvation is not just for the Jews in the time of tribulation, it's also for Gentiles, for non-Jews. You say, how do you know that? Look at Revelation chapter 7, verses 13 and 14. He said to me, "Who are these that are arrayed in white robes? Where did they come from?" And I said unto him, "Sir, you know." "I don't know. You tell me." And the angel said, "These are they that came out of great tribulation, who have washed their robes in the blood of the Lamb." And he goes on to describe them from every people and tribe and tongue and nation. There are a host of people who will come to faith in Jesus Christ, who will believe for the first time ever, Jesus is the Savior, nothing else matters, I need to give my heart and life and soul to him, both Jews and Gentiles. And then the book of Revelation tells us in the 11th chapter that God will save, seal, and send people to be his witnesses during this time of trouble. Forget everything else and everybody else. The most important thing you can do right now is to become a witness for the Lord Jesus Christ. In time, two significant witnesses will rise from among the Jewish people and preach the message of the gospel to them. But the book of Revelation tells us in the 11th chapter, eventually they'll be killed. But then wait, 3.5 days later, they'll be resurrected and raptured up to heaven to be with the Lord, to let the world know that the experience of the millions that disappeared earlier was indeed the rapture, that the rapture has already occurred, and now you see a microcosm of it in the rapture and resurrection of the two witnesses. But then the Antichrist will intensify his hatred of the saved Jews and of the people of Israel in particular. He'll demand that everybody in the world receive the mark of the beast, and then break his covenant with Israel and invade them, according to Daniel, the 9th chapter. He'll go to the temple of God in Jerusalem in 2 Thessalonians 2 and claim that he is God and demand that the world worship him. I would urge you, if you're willing to come to Christ by faith now, don't receive the mark of the beast. Don't believe the lie of the Antichrist. Be a witness for Jesus Christ, even if you have to be faithful unto death. For many of you that come to faith in the time of tribulation, it will cost you your life. But the scripture says in Revelation 2:10 that those that lose their life for the cause of Christ will receive the crown of life, that God will ultimately give you the gift of eternal life. If we're correct in our understanding that the tribulation is 7 years in length, it'll all be over in 7 years after the rapture. And ultimately, Christ himself will return triumphantly. The hope of the future is the triumphant return of Jesus Christ. You can read about it in a Bible in Revelation, the 19th chapter, where we have the statement of the triumphal return of the Lord Jesus Christ, beginning in verse 11. And I saw heaven open, and behold, a white horse, and he that sat upon him was called Faithful and True, and in righteousness he did judge and make war. He's coming back from heaven in a war, in a conflict with the Antichrist. His eyes are like a flame of fire, and on his head there are many crowns, and he has a name written that no one knows. It's the secret, unspoken name of God, and he is clothed in a vesture dipped in blood, and his name is called the Word of God. It's the biblical term for Jesus. In the beginning was the Word, and the Word was with God, and the Word was God. It's Christ who rides out of heaven. Then look at verse 14. The armies that were in heaven followed him upon white horses, clothed in fine linen, white and clean. Where did they receive that white robe? The same chapter tells you in verse 8, at the marriage with Christ in heaven. The church has been raptured to heaven to be married to Christ, to triumphantly return with Christ. The church is coming back to reign and rule with Christ on the earth. And out of his mouth there went a sharp sword, the symbol of his spoken word, that with it he would smite the nations and rule them with a rod of iron. And he treads the winepress of the fierceness of the wrath of Almighty God. And he has on his vesture and on his thigh a name written, King of Kings and Lord of Lords. Hallelujah. Christ is coming. The time of tribulation will come to an end. Jesus will return. And in triumph, the Bible goes on to tell us in that 19th chapter that he'll take the beast and the false prophet and cast them alive into the lake of fire, that he'll bind Satan in the abyss for 1,000 years, and Christ and the church will reign on earth for 1,000 years in a time of wonderful prosperity in the world, a time of millennial blessing, etc., that will bring us into the millennial kingdom. The Old Testament saints will be there. Jesus said, I'll sit down one day with Abraham, Isaac, and Jacob in the kingdom. The tribulation saints will be resurrected, and they'll be brought back to life. They will believe thee there. Everyone that believes the message of the gospel will be there. The message is the same in every era. Jesus died for our sins, was buried, and rose again. If Jesus really is who he said he was, if he's really the Savior, the Son of God, if he died in your place on the cross, the most important thing you can do is to put your faith and your trust in him before it's too late. What message is there for those that have been left behind, and is there any hope?
Oh my, you know, Dr. Ed, I can't imagine someone actually viewing this and listening and thinking that through after the rapture. But if that's the case that they're in, to grab a Bible. There'll be Bibles everywhere. Start reading the Bible. Read the book of Daniel. Start in Matthew as well. Read through the scriptures and find out what the very near future holds in store for you. And ultimately, absolutely, you need to call upon the name of the Lord today. You need to accept Jesus Christ. Of course, you know, you should have done that sooner, but now you've been left behind. And now more than ever, you need to understand that you don't want to make that mistake again. Call upon Jesus now. And then begin to live your life based upon the Word of God. That's the amazing thing, that this Word of God was the Word of God before the rapture. It's the Word of God after the rapture. And you will see at a very fast-paced clip of prophetic events coming to pass, and you need to anchor your soul in the Word of God. It will be your one and only hope, but my friend, it's hope enough to get you through this time, and you will probably be called upon to die for your faith in Jesus Christ. God's grace will be there for you. The power of God's presence will get you through that moment, and we'll see you in heaven.
You know, if God could predict the rapture, and it actually has occurred, then God can certainly predict your future in heaven forever, and in the millennial kingdom of Christ that will come to pass on earth. If you can trust him for salvation, you can trust him for whatever's ahead, and know beyond a shadow of a doubt that the Savior will come for me. Today you've been watching a special message that we prepared for our friends to give to their friends and loved ones who may be left behind one day and wonder, what in the world has happened and what should I do? But could I remind you, death can come at any moment. Jesus could come at any moment. You could step from this life to eternity at any time. You need to know that Jesus is your Savior. Going to heaven is not a matter of, I hope so, I guess I'm going to make it, I think I'm good enough. Nobody's good enough. It's when you come to the end of yourself and realize, I'm a sinner, I'm lost, I need a Savior. and you call on him by faith, oh God, I know that Jesus died for my sins on the cross, that he took the penalty and punishment of sin for me. I'm putting my faith and trust in him today. I want to receive him as my personal Lord and Savior, and pray it by faith. Pray it in Jesus' name. Pray it with a confidence of an amen. God will hear you. God will answer.